Welcome back to section 11.6, and today we're going to talk about the second part of this section, namely the gradient vector, which is going to be an extremely important vector for this class. So by the end of the day, we should be able to calculate this gradient vector for a multivariable function. We should be able to use that to determine the direction in which a function achieves its maximum rate of change. We should be able to actually figure out what is that maximum rate of change. And we should be able to figure out the gradient vector, not from calculation necessarily, but maybe just from a function's contour map. So let's go ahead and get started. To begin with, let's introduce the formula for this quantity called the gradient of a multivariable function f of xy. The gradient vector is denoted in the following way. We've got an upside down triangle here. This symbol is usually read or referred to as the nabla symbol. Nabla, an upside down triangle next to the function's name, in our case f. What is the formula for this function? This is equal to the vector that we get by taking the partial derivative with respect to x of the function and using that as the first x component, and then taking the partial derivative with respect to y and using that with a y component. This vector is usually read out loud as grad f. Now, just a heads up, although sometimes you will see this denoted as grad f with a vector arrow over the nabla symbol, it is not always written with this vector arrow over the nabla symbol. I think this is more common in physics and less common in math to write it with this vector arrow over the nabla. In math, you're mostly expected to know and to remember that nabla f, the gradient vector of f, is in fact a vector. So be on the lookout for that. This is not the first time, and this is definitely not the last time in a math class that you will see a vector that is written without the vector arrow over top of it. So just be on the lookout for that. Now, this particular vector, f of x, f sub y, has actually shown up before when we were calculating the directional derivative. And so we can use the gradient vector to represent the formula for the directional derivative in a slightly different way. So instead of saying that the derivative in the direction of the unit vector u of f is equal to partial x partial with respect to y dot u, we can write it a little bit more compactly as grad f dot u. This is an alternate way to express the formula for the directional derivative. Now, in yesterday's concept check, we asked some questions about the directional derivative, and we asked what vectors would help us to achieve the largest possible rate of change, would help us to achieve the smallest possible rate of change, and what direction would achieve no change for our function. So let's summarize what we learned in yesterday's concept check in the following theorem. The gradient of f of xy is related to the function's rate of change in the following way. If you go in the direction of the gradient vector, and then divide out its length in order to get a unit vector, is the direction of the maximum rate of change. If you want to increase your function's value as quickly as possible, travel in the direction of the function's gradient vector. And we saw that this was the case because the dot product du of f was maximized when u and the gradient vector pointed in the same direction. pointed in the same direction. Now, if you want to achieve the smallest possible rate of change, if you want your function's z value to go down as fast as possible, all you have to do is take the opposite of the gradient vector and go in the opposite direction. So take the negative of grad f, make it a unit vector. Ooh, got a little messy. Make it a unit vector. This is the direction of the minimum rate of change. And finally, if you want to know the actual value of the rate of change, not how to attain that maximum value, but what is the maximum value, you can simply take the magnitude of the gradient vector. So, if you want to know the direction for the maximum rate of change, take the gradient vector, divide out its length. If you want to know the actual rate of change, take the gradient vector and calculate its length. So these are the principles that we extracted from yesterday's concept check. Now let's practice using the definition of the gradient and using the theorem from before to answer the following question. We have a function f of xy, which is equal to 4x squared y plus y to the fifth power. Let's determine, one, the direction of maximum rate of change at the point 2 comma minus 1, and then let's determine the actual value of the maximum rate of change. How to attain the maximum rate, and then what is the maximum rate? So let's go ahead and calculate the gradient vector, which is equal to f sub x in the x component and f sub y in the y component. So let's take the derivative of our given function first with respect to x, treating y as a constant. Now if I take the derivative with respect to x of the first term, 4x squared y, 4y is treated as a constant, x squared becomes 2x by power rule, so I get 4, 2 times 4, x, y. And the y to the fifth power, since y is being treated as constant, y to the fifth power is also constant, and therefore its derivative is equal to 0. For f sub y, let's calculate that. Here, 4x squared times y will become just 4x squared. And then using power rule once again, the y to the fifth power becomes 5y to the fourth power. Now, in particular, they are concerned about the point 2 comma minus 1. So let's go ahead and plug that in to this formula that we have obtained for the gradient vector. So we have 8 times 2 times minus 1, which I guess is minus 16. We have 4 times 4, so 16. 16 plus 5, it looks like, so 21, I suppose. And let's go ahead and find the unit vector in this same direction. So next, let's get the magnitude, which can be found using the distance formula, square root negative 16 squared plus 21 squared. And just a minute as I cook this up in the calculator. Okay, this seems to be the square root of 697. So in the process, by calculating the magnitude of the gradient vector, we have actually answered one of the questions. Namely, we have identified what is the actual maximum rate of change. Finally, in order to answer the question, what is the direction in which we should move, To achieve this max rate of change, I'm going to divide our gradient vector by its length in order to get a unit vector, which is most appropriate for giving definitions. So negative 16 divided by root 697, and 21 divided by root 697. And that would be the direction of the maximum rate of change. Okay, so having calculated this quantity exactly using the definition, let's think a little bit about what we would do if we wanted some information about the gradient vector from, not necessarily from the equation of the function, but perhaps we're in a situation where we just have the contour map. On the contour map of f of xy given below, sketch the gradient vector at the points minus 1, minus 1, and the points minus 1, 0. Okay. So we're going to use two principles in order to answer this question. The first one that we're going to use is the fact that the gradient vector points in the direction of the maximum rate of change for the function, which means that the gradient vector will always point in a direction along which z is increasing. Grad f points toward a higher z value, because the max rate of change will correspond to an increase in the value of z. The second thing that we're going to use is that grad f is the direction of max rate of change . And as a result, it's going to be as far as possible from a direction of no change. In other words, this vector is going to be perpendicular, as far as possible in terms of angles, perpendicular to a level curve. A level curve is a direction of no change. Perpendicular to a level curve is as far from no change as possible. So perpendicular to a level curve is a direction where the function's value is changing as fast as possible. So with these two principles in mind, let's go ahead and sketch the gradient vector at the points minus 1, minus 1, and minus 1, 0. Okay, so minus 1, minus 1, let's get a nice bright color here. Minus 1, minus 1 is going to be in quadrant 3, it looks like, on this pink level curve here. Now, using principle number 2, the gradient vector is either going to extend directly to the bottom right or directly to the top left, because these are two of the directions which are perpendicular to a level curve. But only one of these two directions points in a direction where the z value is higher. This point is on the level curve z equals 0. If I go to the upper left, then the nearby level curve has a smaller z value. But if I go to the bottom right, then the nearby level curve has a higher z value of z equals 1. So this would be a sketch of the gradient vector at the point minus 1, minus 1. Perpendicular to a level curve, pointing in a direction where the z value is higher than what you started with. Okay, and let's try it with the second point as well, where x is negative 1 and y is 0. So that would be right here, I suppose. Once again, we have two possible directions in which we could travel, which are perpendicular to this level curve. We could either travel directly to the right, or we could travel straight to the left. Now this point is on the level curve z equals negative 1. And if we travel to the left, our value will be descending to z equals negative 2. And that's not right. We need z to go up. So our gradient vector will instead point straight to the right, perpendicular to this blue level curve, in a direction where the value of z is larger than what we started with. That is how we sketch the gradient vector from a contour map.